so much of it, we're kind of short of the marketable that we got for draft than we do bottles right now in New York. But we'll have, we're actually making a lot of it at the brewery right now so that we can get it back in the marketplace. But we started making Matilda back in 2000 at a brew pub after I had gone and visited Belgium several times and went to, been over there about 16 times now and visiting a lot of the breweries, including a lot of the Abbey breweries, which are really fun to visit. And probably my favorite is Orval. Orval's way down in the very south of Belgium. And there they make a beer kind of unlike any other. And we liked it so much that we wanted to make a beer in that style. And what makes it really unique is it's fermented not once, but twice. It's fermented with a primary yeast, and then it's re-fermented with a second yeast called Brettanomyces. And Brettanomyces is a wild yeast that really likes to live in barrels, likes to live in wet wood, because it can survive off cellulose. So if you go back about 150 years ago, when every beer and every wine in the whole world was probably aged in a wood barrel, all of them probably had Brett as part of their fermentation, whether they knew it or not. And because of that, all the beers and all the wines have a little bit more of that kind of barnyard earthiness and more complexity. And everything was great until this French guy, this jerk named Louis Pasteur, came along. And he kind of really got to the bottom of microscopy and learned how to keep different yeasts out of the beer and how to kill stuff in the beer through, of course, pasteurization. So, you know, sure, he saved tens of millions of lives, but for those of us who enjoy the finer things in life, you know, we kind of, beer, wine, cheese especially, was never the same. So thankfully, there's some good raw milk cheese and kind of raw beer coming back. In Belgium, there's still a very strong tradition of brewing beers with Brettanomyces, whether they're barrel fermented like a lot of the lambic beers are, or they're like Orval, the bread is actually added in the stainless steel fermenter. So it gives it a lot of that extra complexity. So when we started making this beer, I asked our microbiologist to go out and do some research and look at all the technical brewing papers on bread to see how we should do it. She came back to me about 6 months later and said, you know, there's nothing out there. Because the only brewers that are brewing with bread are either the really small old-fashioned Belgian brewers who don't really understand the science of it, or the monks who aren't always so good at sharing secrets. So we had to kind of figure it out on our own. And when we brew this beer, we ferment it actually three times. We ferment it with our Belgian ale yeast as kind of a base, our base beer. Then we do a secondary, a separate fermentation in a separate vessel with the Brettanomyces. And then we blend the two together and let the bread kind of re-bloom in the blended beer. So that develops an awful lot of complexity in the beer and really makes Matilda pretty unique. We also put in a good amount of caramel malt, which gives it its color, also a little bit richer flavor and more mouthfeel, that we think makes it work really well with foods that have a little bit of richness to them. Scotch egg might fit in that category. Also works really well with spice. A lot of times you see spicy cuisines paired with really, really mild, clean, crisp lagers. And I think they work well as far as refreshment, but they don't really enhance the dish. And I think a beer like Matilda can really enhance the dish because it's got enough malt to kind of absorb the heat of the spice, but it's also got that that spicy yeast complexity to kind of complement the spice. So we like it really. We love it with traditional Belgian food, but and French food. We also like it quite a bit with Thai food, Indian food, Szechuan, even Latin American flavors. We do. There's a restaurant in Chicago called Frontera Grill, which is, certainly the best known high-end Mexican place in Chicago, maybe in the whole country. And this is their best-selling non-Mexican beer. They really try to convince people that, well, yeah, we sell a lot of Bohemia, and they don't sell like Corona, but they really want to enjoy a beer with the meal. They really push on Matilda, and it's actually our biggest Matilda account, bottle account in the city. So we named it after, actually, a Tuscan countess named Matilda, who was a very, very wealthy woman of great influence in the really in the 11th century. She was at her peak. She had a lot of wealth, had a lot of land, married a wealthy guy, married him, had even more wealth and more land. And then she ended up moving up to kind of unincorporated low countries, and there she met her true love. Married another guy, didn't have any wealth, but they were very happy until he went off to battle and never came back. So she went down to her local church and prayed for his return, never came back. Behind the church was a fountain, and back then a fountain was an actual spring that they built a stone wall around so that it wouldn't get muddy. So she was at this spring, and she dropped her wedding ring into the spring. So now she lost a man, and her last tie to a man. So she went back in the church and said, please, if I can't have my husband back, at least my ring. And she came back out and unpopped a trout with the ring in its mouth. So she took the ring, put it on her finger, went back in the church, and gave the majority of her fortune to that church to build an abbey on the site. Which, that abbey is Orval. It's still there today. And if you go to Orval, they'll tell you the story. You can actually look at the Orval label, and there's a trout with the ring in its mouth. And behind the ruins of the old abbey is the Matilda Fountain. It's still there today. So we brew this beer in honor of her. So a toast to Matilda. How much do I have to bring you? Me? Boy, it's kind of a lot.
I drink beer for like breakfast.
It depends on how quick I'm drinking them, and yeah, I have a lot of 20 beer days.
Woo!
Yeah.
You're a man of men.
Yeah. Well, a lot of times when I go out, when I visit other markets, I get picked up by the rep at like 10 a.m. and get dropped off at 2 a.m. and we're having minimum a beer or two an hour. So
that's strong.
Yeah. Excellent. Well, thank you for being an early supporter. We needed them back then. Back then, that's when Chicago was still an old style town. In 88, even in probably 98, we never would have thought we'd sell more beer than old style in Chicago, but our rise has only been surpassed by their decline, so I don't think it's a bad thing. There's more people drinking Chicago beer than old style. Well, it depends. All the English beer we get over here is that. Belgian mash rye.
That's pretty good.
Of course, the cask was rye. So the cask ale is never
transferred. I was told that American beer, you had to have it. You had to alcohol in rye. So that's why, yeah.
So that they
doesn't fight.
Well, the big American beer is cask rye beer. But most of the small ones
don't.
So you get more of that fresh flavor.
Can we get a picture with you, Greg?
Oh, sure.